thing that most Elasmobranchs have in common is a limiting life history strategy, in that they're slow growing and thus mature at a later age and a larger size. They have fewer offspring and generally they're quite long lived. Therefore, this life history strategy can make them particularly susceptible to overexploitation. Elasmobranchs face numerous challenges, and these can be compounded by their life history. Undoubtedly, fishing pressure is the largest impact on most Elasmobranchs, and there are additional anthropogenic impacts coming through, such as habitat loss, through the installation of offshore wind farms, for example, and through eutrophication, which can lead to seasonal hypoxia. As Elasmobranchs are top predators, any decline in these species could lead to trophic cascades and also reduce biodiversity. Therefore, it's really important that we closely monitor these stocks regularly. I'm Sophy McCully Phillips, and I am the current chair of the ICES Working Group for Elasmobranch Fishes. Elasmobranchs are a subclass of fish characterised by having a cartilaginous skeleton rather than that made of bone like teleost fish. There are two superorders of Elasmobranchs, one being the sharks and the other being the skates, rays and sawfish, known as batoids. So what differentiates these two groups? Well, sharks typically have a more fusiform body shape that makes them more streamlined and reduces drag so that they're quicker through the water, whereas batoids are more dorsiventrally flattened and they lay closer to the seafloor. Of course, there are always exceptions to the rule. An angel shark is one of these. This is found in the ICES area and is a true shark, but is actually dorsiventrally flattened, and it has its eyes on the dorsal side of its body. The position of the gill slits is another characteristic, with sharks having 5 to 7 pairs of gill slits on either side of the head, while skates and rays have 5 to 6 pairs of gill slits on the underside of their body.
They are also important indicators of ecosystem health and biodiversity. Due to their high trophic level, specific life history traits, they are particularly sensitive to environmental changes or anthropogenic disturbances. Declines in Elasmobranchs can be indicative of broader ecosystem issues. Therefore, monitoring the status of populations is important to gain insight into the overall health of ecosystems. There are several techniques that allow us to study Elasmobranchs. For example, telemetry techniques, new genetic techniques, but also imaging techniques. Firstly, the telemetry techniques like acoustic tagging, data storage tags, or satellite tags allow us to identify migration routes, critical habitats such as breeding grounds, as well as areas of high activity. And these actually provide us crucial information for management measures. Another new, very promising technique is the use of genetics, such as DNA barcoding, population genetics, or environmental DNA. Genetics can help us identify species, assess genetic diversity. It can also help us to look at the population size and population structure of Elasmobranchs. For example, the use of DNA in closed skin marker capture, which has been done in white sharks, but also in skates and rays populations in the Northeast Atlantic, can help us actually look at the population structure and size of these species. Furthermore, we have environmental DNA that has been successfully used to identify Elasmobranch species in their habitats, especially for those that are rare and cannot be directly observed. In general, genetics can be seen as a very powerful tool to monitor Elasmobranchs in their environment. The third element which we can use is imaging technologies, ranging from use of high-resolution satellite images to actually using cameras on board of commercial fishing vessels. These techniques allow us to actually capture images of the Elasmobranch behavior and catches, and can actually help us align species composition in fisheries. Reducing the bycatch of Elasmobranchs is rather challenging and is mainly regulated through fisheries management. Management measures include catch limits, size restrictions, and establishing seasonal closures or area closures. For example, these closures can restrict fishing activities during certain periods of time in specific areas. Implementing such closures is essential for Elasmobranch habitats or during critical life stages. However, such measures really have proven effective in safeguarding populations. They really require a strong regulatory framework to be controlled and enforced. Ensuring the long-term conservation of these species requires critical actions at policy, management, and scientific levels. Continued research and monitoring are crucial for the understanding of Elasmobranch populations, the ecological interactions, and the impact of human activities.
Undoubtedly, there has been a decline in many Elasmobranch stocks across the about 15 years I've been working in this field. This has been evident from what I've seen on the ground during research vessel surveys, but also through analysing trends in survey indices and catch data as submitted to the working group. However, it's not all negative. We now see some really positive trends and recoveries in some species, such as the commercially exploited rioty, as well as some shark species, after many years of zero or low catch rates. A recent success story is that of spurdog. This is a species that was the target of longline fisheries across the Northeast Atlantic. And being an aggregating species, the catches were high, with landings peaking about 60,000 tonnes in the 1960s, and this remained about 30,000 to 40,000 tonnes through the 1980s and 1990s. Fishers targeted the large mature females as they attain a larger size and therefore higher market value. Consequently, this led to the stock collapse. And with management lacking behind scientific advice, it wasn't until about 2007 that the TAC became restrictive, which was too late for this long-lived species. The zero TAC was fully introduced to EU vessels in 2011. Now fast forward 12 years of having this zero TAC, and the stock is now showing positive signs of recovery, and the latest ICES advice indicates that catches around 17,000 tonnes would be sustainable. Management has also incorporated a maximum landing length of 100 centimetres to avoid that targeting of the large females again. And this is a data-rich stock, and the advancement of assessment methodologies, which have incorporated both historic and contemporary data on fecundity, has led to a more robust understanding of the stock status.
Scientific information that we need is, for example, population assessments, genetic assessments, but also tracking movements and monitoring changes in habitat quality. Robust scientific data and information can inform evidence-based management decisions and adaptive conservation strategies. Communication with fishing communities, fishers, and other stakeholders is essential for successful conservation of these species. Encouraging their participation and involvement in decision-making processes will give them a sense of ownership and may help them adopt sustainable fishing practices. Collaboration among governments, scientists, conservation organizations, and fisheries is essential to address the complex challenges that these species face and can ensure a sustainable future of Elasmobranchs in our oceans.